But it was his home, where he belonged, and where he was finally going. The big clock on the wall topped round to 5 o'clock. A blister lifted up the flap on the counter and turned the sign on the door closed. Bailey's perfect chamois kebab emporium shut up in the day. He grabbed his overcoat and scarf, pulled on his fur-lined deerstalker and mittens, and walked out into the crisp, white snow. The bell on the door gently rang. There was never any need to lock the shop, not here at Bedford Falls. Lister crunched across the Eiderdown Street and headed for the bank. A group of carol singers were standing round the war memorial, belting out God Rest Ye Merry Gentlemen. Merry Christmas, he said, and dropped $2 into their can. It being after 5 o'clock on Christmas Eve, the bank was closed, of course. Lister found the door. It jangled open.
Hello!
Horace stepped through the back door, holding a sheet of wrapping paper and some string. Charlie, Mr. Burley, how is it rare and great and so good when the war comes home? The air is bad and rather even. I'll be a monkey's uncle back there. Just a smile, he pulled out a handful of candlesticks from a small vertical pocket.
I didn't have time to wrap them, but the orphan is pretty loud.
They won't mind, Gordon.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas, Horace,
said Lister, and walked back out into the street, where his rickety old Model A Ford was covered in snow. He took the hand crank from the bench seat and jerked the engine into spluttering life. As he turned left at Martini's bar, his arm started to hurt again, so he pulled over outside Old Man Gower's drugstore. His arms have been giving him problems for a few weeks now. It was like a burning sensation down both his forearms, excruciatingly painful at times. But Dr. Pence couldn't find anything wrong with them. There were no marks. Nothing showed up on the x-ray. It was a complete mystery. He grabbed a tub of cooling ointment from Old Man Gower's shelves and dropped 25 cents into the open till, then hopped back in his own Ford and headed for home. It had been 2 years since they returned to Earth. 2 years since they'd skidded to a landing in the middle of the Sahara Desert. As they opened the airlock and stepped out into the foggy heat, an army of jeeps and helicopters descended on them. The world's press went crazy. A 3 million-year-old man. Space adventurers. Rimmer knocked it up. The captain boarded. But Lister just wanted to get away. He changed his name to Joe Bailey and opted for the peaceful anonymity of a backwater town in the American Midwest. He couldn't believe it when he discovered there actually was a town called Bedford Falls. He gone there on a whim to take a look and was stunned by how similar the place was to the Bedford Falls in the movie It's a Wonderful Life. It seemed like fans of the film really collected there to live out their lives in a self-created 1940s American Shangri-La. But something was wrong with his hands, and it was beginning to worry him. He turned the Ford into the tree-lined yard of his old house and parked his way up 3 times. The snow lay thick and deep in the road, and a huge 8-foot snowman was grinning away from the cold. He looked into the parlor, a bonfire.
Shit! No!
Jim and Bexley were smashing silent lines out of him playing the piano, but Chrissy was standing on step ladder, putting tinsel on the Christmas tree. When the kids were in bed, they sat snoozily in the big leather armchair with the springs poking through the back, watching the fire splatter and splurt, and listening to Hobie Carmichael on the wind-up phonograph. After Chrissy climbed the stairs to their drafty bedroom with a leaky roof, he took out the ointment. He didn't want her to know about his arms, and began to apply it to the sore areas. It came as something of a shock that, when he put the cream specifically on the areas that throbbed and hurt, it spelled out a word written in pain down his forearm. The word was dying. A black stretch Mercedes with a tinted bulletproof glass. glass, glided along the Champs-Élysées, and pulled up outside the canopy of the 140-floor skyscraper. Wilmot finished his phone call to his publicist, then stepped out of the limo. A string of bodyguards kept at bay the group of teenage girls camped out on the steps overnight in the hope of catching a glimpse of AJR. He allowed